A very long road to today's trial of a former Klansman and the work of one newspaper to reopen chapters of civil rights history. Media correspondent Terence Smith reports.
This newspaper, as I said earlier, has certainly changed drastically.
That's Merle Evers Williams, chairman emeritus of the NAACP and widow of slain civil rights leader Medgar Evers, addressing the editorial board of the Clarion-Ledger newspaper in Jackson, Mississippi.
And here I am, sitting here with you now. I look at your board. I look at your staff. It's so different than what was. And I'm so pleased to see it.
What makes her words and her presence in the publisher's suite all the more striking is the history of this newspaper, which for years assailed both her late husband and the movement he helped lead. Before and during the civil rights era, the Clarion-Ledger and its now defunct afternoon sibling, the Jackson Daily News, were family-owned newspapers, the largest in Mississippi. They not only helped perpetuate segregation, many in Mississippi say they helped inflame it.
They were probably one of the very worst newspapers in the country, and they were segregationists at heart.
Newspaper man Bill Miner chronicled the civil rights struggle from Jackson for the New Orleans Times-Picayune. His reporting won him awards, but few friends in the Mississippi establishment. He still writes a syndicated column that today appears in 30 regional papers, including the Clarion-Ledger. Miner said the Jackson papers, then owned by the Hederman family, were attacked as seg or segregationist rags. Some critics branded the morning paper the Clarion Liar.
Bigotry would be at the soul of it, in my estimation, although I would say 90% of them would go to church on Sunday and be in the amen pew, so to speak.
Editorials in both Hederman papers railed against integration, the Jackson Daily News decrying race-mixing agitators, and a front page warning against the mongrelization of the human race. And this front page headline appeared after the 1963 March on Washington. Washington is clean again, with Negro trash removed.
They really promoted segregation through their paper in different ways. And of course, we learned in later years and suspected back then that they were being fed these reports from the State Sovereignty Commission, which is this, I used to call it the KGB of the cotton patches.
Native Mississippian John Hammock has worked at the paper on and off since 1962. He too remembers the Mississippi Sovereignty Commission, the secret state-sanctioned agency founded in 1956 to undermine federal desegregation efforts and the budding civil rights movement. Hammock says the Clarion-Ledger acted as a political arm of the white power structure, largely forbidding its reporters from covering the civil rights movement.
So what we reporters did was to go out and cover the stories, come back and feed the information to the Associated Press, who would put it out under an AP carrot, and the stories would be published in the paper. And if a question were ever raised about it, the official word was, that's that liberal AP that's turning out those stories. Those are not our guys writing it.
Hammock vividly recalls another example of the paper's coverage during that era. An Associated Press story about the arrest of Byron Dela Beckwith for the killing of Medgar Evers said Beckwith, seen here on the right being booked, had moved to Mississippi as an infant, but had been born in California.
And Mr. Hewitt said, oh, we have to make use of that. And they turned the story around, and the headline on the story was, and they rewrote the story to get it higher. I just remember the California man arrested.
And except for a small weekly section called Colored News, Jackson's black community did not exist in the pages of the Hederman papers. Merle Evers Williams.
None of the news of what my people were doing in our community was available to us. Medgar often said, you know, we live behind the cotton curtain as far as the media was concerned.
But by the 1970s, the Clarion-Ledger began to change. A young Hederman, Ray, the first in the family to have studied journalism, took over.
Integration is more than just opening doors. It's equal opportunity and equal rights. And Ray embraced that wholeheartedly.
The younger Hederman instituted the first obituaries for blacks and had his staff actively cover Jackson's large black community. Many at the paper credit Ray Hederman with setting the stage for today's Clarion-Ledger. Now owned by Gannett, the nation's largest newspaper chain, the paper has published groundbreaking reporting that has led to the reopening of old civil rights era murder cases. Clarion-Ledger investigative reporter Jerry Mitchell has been digging into this story for 13 years.
What's amazing to me is to be able to find out new things about things that we thought we already knew everything about.
However, as a child growing up in Texas, Mitchell says he knew little about the civil rights movement.
You know, it's almost like it happened on Pluto or something. I mean, about all I really remember from the civil rights movement is when Martin Luther King was assassinated. I mean, that was the only event, really, that really resonated.
But decades after King's death, Mitchell's dogged reporting, combined with a new generation of aggressive federal and local prosecutors, has led to the reinvestigation of 20 civil rights era killings. To date, a total of 23 people have been arrested, leading to 7 manslaughter and murder convictions, 1 mistrial, and 1 acquittal. Atlanta-based jury consultant Andrew Sheldon has assisted prosecutors on 5 of the trials.
I call these the reconciliation cases. To me, we have a huge wound as a culture because of the way we have treated an entire race of people. Jerry's part is seminal. I mean, it's just without him, who knows? It may never have happened.
In 1989, Mitchell gained access to sealed files from the State Sovereignty Commission that showed that the agency hindered the prosecution of the 1963 murder of Medgar Evers outside his Jackson home. Thanks to his reporting and the tireless efforts of Merle Evers Williams and local prosecutor Bobby DeLauter, the case was reopened in 1989. White supremacist Byron D. LeBeckwith, whose 2 tainted trials for the murder resulted in hung juries in 1964, was reindicted in 1990. Shortly before that, Mitchell interviewed Beckwith outside Chattanooga.
Signal Mountain is a beautiful place when the sun is going down, but not if you happen to be with Byron D. LeBeckwith. And so he walks me out to the car, and he said, if you write positive things about white Caucasian Christians, God will bless you. If you write negative things about white Caucasian Christians, God will punish you. If God does not punish you directly, several individuals will do it for him.
Merle Evers Williams reacted to Beckwith's 1994 conviction, which came almost 30 years to the day after his first trial.
All I want to do is say, yay, Medgar, yay, yay, yay. I know the third trial. Along with the work of the Clarion-Ledger, led by Jerry, said 1,000 words to the national public as a whole, that even though these murders, these lynchings, these assassinations took place years ago, that there's still time to right those wrongs.
While serving a life sentence, Byron D. LeBeckwith died last year. And starting today in Birmingham, Alabama, the trial of former Klansman Bobby Frank Cherry will open for one of the most horrific crimes of the civil rights era, the September 1963 bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church that killed 4 little girls. Another man, Thomas Blanton, was convicted last year. Mitchell's reporting destroyed Cherry's alibi.
The FBI had already been investigating the case, and actually, he asked me to come interview him.
He asked you to interview him?
Yes, he did. And I was kind of surprised by that. I wouldn't exactly be at the top of the list of people to pick, I would think. So I spent about 6 hours with him, talking with him, and he said, well, I didn't have anything to do with that bombing. I left that sign shop, and the sign shop is about 2.5 blocks from where the church blew up. So I left that sign shop at 9:45 because I had to get home and watch wrestling.
Mitchell checked the television listings. There was no wrestling broadcast the night the bomb was planted, or for years thereafter. Cherry's alibi, which had gone unchallenged for 3.5 decades, was in ruins.
I think that in some cases, the best way to heal an old wound is to open it up.
Jackson's mayor, Harvey Johnson Jr., says the successful reopening of the civil rights cases has helped bring painful but necessary change.
The old days are no more here in Mississippi, and I think that, again, this is reflective of the current attitude and the level of progress, social progress, that we've reached here in the state. And I think that the paper should be commended for what it's doing.
Mississippi has changed dramatically since the bad old days when, as one author put it, the scent of the magnolias mixed with the smell of burning crosses. But attitudes change slowly here. When a proposal to remove the Confederate symbol from the state flag was put to a referendum not long ago, a solid majority voted to keep the flag and its tradition intact. Mac Hales, a hardware salesman and regular reader of the Clarion-Ledger, has mixed feelings about the impact of the paper's reporting.
Everybody's not a redneck here. We're good people. We work hard, and we want things to be right.
Has it made a difference when some of these things are settled, when convictions when convictions are arrived at?
I think so. I think it satisfied the people of the other race, and it satisfied the people of my race to get the truth out and get it over with.
I'm doing okay.
Just up the street at Brent's Drugs, Jean Jeffries says she fears dredging up the past may bring more negative press to Mississippi.
There you go.
We have made so much progress down here. It's a shame we can't go in a positive way instead of a negative way.
And how will she view the Bobby Frank Cherry trial?
I hope I can be objective. And
you think you can?
I hope I can. I don't know that I can, but I hope I can.
There are those who are not objective. The Clarion-Ledger regularly receives angry letters to the editor about its coverage, and threats have been leveled against Mitchell and his family.
Some people have been pretty upset about it. I've had friends tell me, you know, what are you doing digging up this stuff? You know, why don't you leave it alone?
But Mitchell thinks that would be a mistake for himself and Mississippi.
I think there is redemption in doing the right thing, whether it's me, or whether it's Mississippi, or the South, or the nation, or any of us.
That redemptive journey continues this week in a Birmingham courtroom when Bobby Frank Cherry stands trial for the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church.